visible on your screens. Kindly fill that so that we are able to provide you with e-certificates. So let's get started. Welcome again, everyone, to this session. So I'll begin with a brief introduction about eGalactic. eGalactic has more than 11 years of experience in this field, and the basic goal is to assist the institutes to enhance the quality of education. We try to understand the needs of the education market and then address those needs with the best available products across the globe. The products that we are offering are being used by more than 1,500 universities and institutes in India and more than 10,000 institutes globally across 100 plus countries. So here we have the list of our products. The first one is a plagiarism detection system by the name Urkund. The second is a thesis management system called SkyPro. Then the third is the field of business simulation games, whereby we offer a variety of products. We have MarkStrat for marketing, the business strategy game for strategy, Forad in the field of finance. And apart from this, we also have other products like Brand Pro, Digital Media Pro, Boss, and Mix Pro. Let's get to the objective of today's session. We are going to discuss on plagiarism as well as how to address plagiarism in our day-to-day lives. And after that, we'll be moving on to the detailed Urkund plagiarism detection system. So let's have a look at the world higher education scenario. So if we go through this data, we are able to see that the number of enrollments in higher education scenario has gone up in the last 15 years. If you compare the 2000 data with the 2016 data, you'll see that the number has increased manifold times. From 99.9 million in 2000, the number has more than doubled and has reached a value of around 215.9 million in the year 2016. And if you talk about the year 2020, this number must have increased further. And here, if you talk about the India's contribution to this, so earlier, India's the total number of enrollments in the year 2000 was around 10 million, and this has increased to around 40 million in 2016. And if you calculate the percentage of total enrollments in higher education scenario, like comparison of India's contribution to that, in the year 2000, it was around 10%. And if you talk about the year 2016, this has almost doubled and has reached around 18.5%. But if you see the advancement, if you see like the share of students achieving the advanced threshold, as well as the share of students achieving the minimum threshold, if you look at this data in this graph, this is quite disheartening, because here we are able to see that in the share of the students achieving the advanced threshold also, we are almost on the minimum side. And in the share of students achieving the minimum threshold also, we are almost on the minimum side. This may sound not very appealing to others, but what I am trying to emphasize on is that we have a long way to go, and there's a lot of scope whereby we can contribute to this, and we can improve the scenario of higher education in India. So we have a distance to travel, and all of us need to get together to achieve this. Now, let's understand as to what is plagiarism. How do we define plagiarism? So basically, plagiarism exists when someone describes another's thoughts or words as though they were one's own. When you do not give the original author the due credit for their work, then their work is said to have been plagiarized. Now, plagiarism could be textual similarity, it could be structural similarity, or it could be conceptual similarity. The next question that arises is, why do you consider it wrong? Because one fails to assimilate all the knowledge and skills and does not give acknowledgement to the entitled person. Moreover, it prevents the plagiarizing students from learning, and also fraudulently deceives the person who is marking their work. So the need of the hour is to prevent plagiarism in order to motivate these students to develop original thoughts and ideas. We would also like to contribute to enhance the learning process. And the last but not the least is that we want to encourage students to use sources correctly, use references, and to give due credit to the person whose work they are using. This is the reason why the need of the hour is to prevent plagiarism. Now, talking about plagiarism, we now move on to the next one. We are actually trying to understand the reason as to why does plagiarism exist. So there are a number of reasons because of which plagiarism exists, but we would be discussing a few here. The first is that there's an assumption that it is okay to plagiarize. If you look at the educational system in India, what we see is from the very beginning, from the primary section onwards, we are actually expected to reproduce whatever has been taught to us. The teacher either writes the answers for us, or maybe the answers are asked to, maybe we mark the answers from this page to this page, from this paragraph to this paragraph. And at the end, during the examination, we would reproduce whatever has been asked by the teachers and whatever has been taught to us during the entire session. So that is how we are being groomed up. So the first and the foremost reason is that there's an assumption that it is okay to plagiarize, because that's what we have been doing since the very beginning. We've been doing that, we've been copying whatever has been taught to us. So there's always an assumption when we come to higher education scenario also, we assume that it is okay to plagiarize. The second is, of course, the lack of subject understanding. We see this far and wide, that the subject is not very, very clear. Maybe you could see in the educational scenario, what we see is that the primary and the secondary education are generally covered in regional covered in regional languages. And English may not necessarily be the core language that is being used by the students. Now, once they come to the higher education, once they come to, say, masters and PhDs and their bachelor courses, language is of course a problem. There could be lack of subject understanding. And in case if the subject is not understood very well, we think that the easier resort is to simply copy paste from any of the sources that we can lay our hands on. The third is that we plagiarize in order to get better grades. If we look around ourselves, we'll see that we are all running in a rat race. And what matters is not work, is not the knowledge that we have gained. We all emphasize only on the grades, because the grades have become a parameter to judge someone's knowledge and to judge how much does that person know. So one very important reason why we have been plagiarizing, or why students plagiarize across, is that they want to get better grades, because somehow that idea may be there that in case if they write things in their own words, they cannot score great grades. So in order to get better grades, they start plagiarizing from other sources. Yet another point is lack of writing skills. We may not be having so much confidence in the language in which we are writing the work. As I was talking about it, that in the primary sections, many a times the schools are being run in regional languages. The medium of instruction in the schools is the regional languages. So expertise in English is probably not there with the students, due to which they are not confident that they can write their work in their own words. And since lack of writing skills is there with them, they think it is easier to plagiarize. So the confidence of writing something in either English or maybe some other language is missing in the students, because of which they simply plagiarize. Moreover, there's also one important reason, and that is lack of planning. Most of the times we'll see that planning is not being done properly by the students. Most of the cases you'll see that the work is not being started till half of the time gets over. And in the last half left, we would start with the work. There's last minute work, there's not proper planning. We do not have the knowledge of the subject. We do not have thoughts, we do not have the notes ready with us. In that case, the only thing that is left with us is to plagiarize. So we find it easier to simply copy paste from some sources. Moreover, There could be a scenario where there is unwillingness to work or lack of motivation. So in case if the students are not motivated themselves, or maybe they're not willing to work, in that case, the most easy thing is to simply plagiarize. And that is what they do, because they do not want to put in the required effort. They do not want to collect their thoughts. They do not want to go through the subject, gain the insight on the concepts, and put in the efforts to write something. So the best thing that they find is that they can, that they simply copy paste it from the sources. And the last is, of course, lack of confidence also. In case the students are not confident enough due to any reason whatsoever, they're not confident that they'll be able to write properly whatever they have gained in the classes, if they lack that confidence, then also they'll find it difficult to write something in their own words. And ultimately, that part is plagiarized from maybe their peers, or maybe from some other sources, or maybe from internet. So these are a few reasons because of which plagiarism exists in our day-to-day scenario. Now the question is, how do we avoid plagiarism? So there are a variety of ways by which you can avoid, by which you can decide how are you going to avoid plagiarism. The first is, you should decide that you will do your own work. So the first and foremost thing is that this decision has to come from the students, that they are willing to do their own work. So for that, the faculties may also need to work with the students. Maybe a kind of productive environment has to be set up. We need to work with the students to give them the confidence that they will be able to write their work properly. They do not need to copy it from somewhere else. So the students need to have that willingness. They need to take that decision. At the same time, we need to have a constructive environment whereby the students are able to take the initiative and start writing their own work. The second is that we need to whenever a work has been given to us, whenever we have been provided with a project or something, we need to plan in advance how are we going to go ahead with it. We need to do a lot of reading. We need to collect our thoughts, maybe prepare some rough notes, and then go ahead with it. So a proper planning has to be done in advance so that you are able to complete your work in the stipulated time. Because in most of the cases, since the time was not planned in advance, that was the reason why last minute copying from some other source was needed. So we need to plan very much in advance so that we are not in that unfavorable situation. The next is that we should be investing in the topic. Unless and until we know the subject very, very well, we would not be able to write that work in our own words. So the most important thing, or the first step that we need to take, is that we need to invest in the topic. We need to do a lot of reading, get our hands on the various material that is available on that particular topic. We need to read that, we need to collect our thoughts, and then come up with a few notes, and then decide how are we going to present it finally, and then go ahead with it. So investment in the topic is also equally important. Once we have the content, once the concept is clear to us, we will be able to write that in our own words. Moreover, there are other ideas also. The students should be aware that they need to quote the sources. In case if the students have taken someone else's work, in case if they have taken some content, maybe from the internet or maybe from some published material, journals, articles, etc. In that case, they need to properly quote the sources so that they are able to give the due credit to the concerned person whose work they have used in their paper. So quoting of sources is also equally important. The student should not simply copy paste someone else's work. They should quote that work properly so that they are able to give due credit to the person. Moreover, the students should also be told that they need to use citations and add references in their work. So adding citations and using citations and adding references is also an equally important thing. They need to cite their work. They need to add references to the work which they have taken from some other places. And that way, they are able to avoid plagiarism, because then they have given the credit to the person whose work they have used in their work. Moreover, if the students are citing their own material, they should also be told that they need to cite the own material. So what to cite and what not to cite has to be made clear to them in the very beginning itself. We need to tell them that they need to cite someone else's work, use citations for someone else's work, as well as they need to cite their own material. And also they need to be told as to what not to cite, so that the students are able to go ahead with it properly, and then it is not considered as plagiarism. And the students should also try to invest so much in the topic so that they are able to paraphrase it or maybe write it in their own words. So paraphrasing is also an important tool with which the students will be able to avoid plagiarism. So one way to avoid plagiarism is use paraphrasing and also writing your own bibliography, because then you give the details of all the sources from where the content was taken. And in this way, you have given the due credit to the person whose work was used in your paper or in your project. So using these basic steps, we can avoid plagiarism. Basically, a constructive environment has to be created. The teachers need to bring these, to discuss these details with the students beforehand, so that the students are able to work properly since day one, and they are able to decide as to what needs to be done and what does not need to be done in order to avoid plagiarism. So a few ways by which we can avoid plagiarism. Now we are moving on to a very important thing, that is percentage values in the reports. So the topic is why percentages are not important for bachelor courses. So in our opinion, percentages have been misleading people since the classical era. So we'll explain this with examples, letter size, and of the I'm sorry for the disturbance. So we were talking about the percentage here with an example. So let's say there was a block of text of 4 lines, which was written in your original words. The second was the same block of text in which the last 2 lines you have swapped off with something of Wikipedia unaltered. And the same block with the last 2 lines adjusted so that it was in your own words and shows a 50% match to the original. So what the question is, that does it really matter? Surely the fact that it contains plagiarism is more important than whether it is 25% or 50% plagiarized. But of course, we are talking about bachelor courses only. So in bachelor courses, the fact that the work contains plagiarism is far more important than whether it is 25% or 50% plagiarized. Now, here we have the devil or the deep blue sea. So let us understand this with an example. So basically, devil or the deep blue sea is something like you are in a situation whereby you have to choose between 2 unfavorable situations only. So here, what you can see, there are so many examples. These are the ways which are being followed. You could change out your quotations to reduce the percentage. So what do we do is we change the quotations in order to reduce the percentage. But here we have ignored that it would lead to a break in the structure, and it would also change the meaning of how it is reading. Moreover, many a times we see that a lot more is added to your essay to increase its size and reduce the percentage. So what we are doing is, in order to get a lower percentage, we are adding more content to your work in order to increase its size and reduce the percentage. But here what we have done is we have ignored how this is a terrible idea and how this is going to dilute the content of the essay as well as reduce the impact of the point which is made by the student, and it also devalues the subject. So these are the a few of the practices which are being followed. You could change out the quotations to reduce the percentage. Add more content, but to the point that is made by this, moreover, it also devalues the subject. Let's again take one more example whereby what we are trying to do is just see the game of percentages here. So there's a book, Orwell's 1984, which has around 400 pages. Again, we have Orwell's another book, which is known as Animal Farm, that is about 100 pages long. Let's take up Stephen King's book, The Stand, that is about 1,350 pages long. Now, how would you feel if I had put 1984 in The Stand? So I have put 400 pages of 1984 in the 1,350 pages long book, The Stand. And if you take out the percentage, interestingly, it is 29.63%. Now, suppose if I have put Animal Farm in the book, The Stand, it would be scored at only 7.41%. But the question that we need to ask is that okay? Would you feel like reading something like that? No, this is not okay, and this cannot be seen as okay. So what we are trying to say is that percentages are not all. Especially in bachelor courses, it is much more than percentage. So the question that arises here is, how do we treat the score? So there can be so many ways by which you treat the score. Number one, you can treat the score as an information. Why? Because it is simply informing the receiver that a certain part of the document has been found somewhere else, and this is neither good nor bad. So the percentage value should be treated as an information, because it is simply informing the reviewer that a certain part of the document has been found somewhere else. It is not saying anything more and anything less than that. It is not putting a tag that this is good or this is bad. If you take certain examples, for example, a 0% document, it does not contain any references that have been found by the system. So here, this paper might not up to the academic standards, but it could be a creative writing piece and thus is fine. So simply by looking at a 0% figure, we cannot decipher anything. The paper could not be academically good, it could not be up to the academic standards, but it could be a creative writing piece. In the same way, if you take up a 100% document, why did we get 100%? There could be two reasons. Because it was submitted before in the system, or maybe it has been taken from another source. So you could have resubmitted your work, that is why you got 100% score, because it was submitted before by you, or you are getting 100% because this has been copied from another sources. So here, if you see, this 100% score can be either perfectly acceptable or it can be absolutely unacceptable. It depends on the situation. Simply by looking at 100%, we cannot judge that this is acceptable or this is totally unacceptable. So what we are trying to emphasizing is every report must be checked to see how much of what has been flagged is acceptable, referencing or quotations, and how much is plagiarism. So what we are trying to emphasize here, the message that we want to get across is that every report must be checked to see how much of what has been flagged is acceptable based on references, based on quotations, and how much of that is plagiarism. So you please take the time and you decide whether that is simply similarity or whether that is plagiarism. So that was the point, what we were trying to make here. And let's take up a case of a typical project work. So why only one or maximum two submissions are needed? So here, this is a typical project scene, whereby let us say that a student was expected to submit a project, and that too within a span of 10 days. So initially we'll see that, so we see that for most of the cases, the first few days, that is say till day five, day four, the work is not being started. Most of the students will not start working in the initial days. So what we start doing is from day six onwards, we start doing our work. So we work for 2 or 3 days, and by the end of the day or day eight, or maybe day nine, we have a rough draft in our hand. So what we'll do is we'll start like checking it in the system, and we'll try to find how much of that has been plagiarized. And the most productive period, that is day 9 and day 10, we will see that what we are trying to do is on the day 8 and day 9, we have run the report against the system. We have a plagiarism report. So the basic focus has shifted from the quality of report to the plagiarism percentage, because in the last 2 days, what we are going to do is we'll be working only on reducing the percentage of similarity or reducing the percentage of plagiarism found in the report, and the focus will entirely shift. So there are a few poll questions and which can be answered by the participants. So the focus shifts from the quality of report to the plagiarism percentage here. So let's get ahead here. So here what has happened is that the focus has shifted from the quality of the report to plagiarism percentage. We are not working on to how to improve the quality of the report. The basic idea is to get the report well within under the acceptable percentage range. So here the focus has entirely shifted, and we have wasted the most productive period in working only on the percentage of similarity. Now, in summary on percentage for bachelor courses, so here there are a few summaries on this. The first is percentages are absolute except when they are not, and there's no magical percentage. Only by looking at a particular percentage, you cannot decide anything. The percentage, like for any report, the entire report has to be read, and then you need to come to a particular conclusion, because there's no magical percentage and there can be no magical percentage. And even if there were a magical percentage, its value cannot be decided by a computer or a plagiarism detection provider. And using arbitrary percentages to decide whether an essay is acceptable or not, is itself unacceptable to the teacher, the student, as well as the subject. So kindly do not go only by arbitrary percentages to decide whether an essay is acceptable or not, or is not unacceptable. This is not acceptable to the teacher, to the student, as well as to the subject. So kindly do not go only by the percentage that is generated for the report. Let's talk about the education system. We've been talking about it since the starting of the session. So here, this is the typical educational scenario here. Pardon me if you do not agree with this slide, but this slide is based on our observations of the education system in India. I'm not here to criticize on it, but these are our observations, and we've just trying to discuss this with you. If we talk about the level of education, that is pre-primary, primary scenario, maybe the kids who are going to kindergarten, UKG, LKG, etc. For these kids, the writing work is almost negligible, and the number of pages that they need to write is, say, they are supposed to write only 1% or so on. And the expectation is that the student should be writing the original answers. So here what is happening is that the students do not learn a particular answer. Moreover, if you ask him or her a particular question again and again, they'll come up with different answers every time, because the answers that come up are original. There's no reproduction in them. They have not they have not learned certain answers, and they are coming up with their original answers. But as we move ahead the ladder, primary, secondary, and higher secondary scenario, we see that the writing work starts increasing from one page to up till 20 pages. And the expectation that has been set on us is that we need to reproduce whatever has been taught. So certain answers are being provided to us, or maybe we are asked to mark the answers, and that is what the expectation is, that you will reproduce whatever has been taught. But when we move ahead to the higher education scenario here, we'll be able to see in the bachelor's, master's, and PhD, the focus shifts entirely, because here in the bachelor's course, the expectation is still that you can reproduce. But as we move ahead, once we move on to the higher education scenario, like master's and PhD, we are expected to write everything in our own words. So what is happening here is that something which we have done all throughout our life, here the focus shifts entirely, and we are expected to write the entire thesis, the entire reports, maybe of 200 pages in our own work. So I think this is too much to expect out of the students, because how can we expect a student who has not written even half a page of an answer or maybe half a page of an essay in his own words? How can we expect him to write the entire work of maybe 200 pages of 100 pages in his own words? So here the expectation changes. And what we are trying to emphasize is that the plagiarism detection software should be introduced we should try to introduce them in the bachelor's level itself, so that they are being told that this is what is expected out of them, and the expectation is being set on them. They start working on it, and by the end of their final, and when they're writing their final year papers, a lot has changed. And once they move on ahead in higher educational scenario, once they go for their master's and PhD, then this difficulty is lessened. They do not face so much of difficulty, because that has been put into practice since bachelor's itself. So the basic idea is that Urkun should be introduced in the bachelor's level. We should try to have plagiarism detection softwares as early as bachelor's course, so that we set the right expectations on them. Let's move ahead and let us understand as to how does Urkun help in this scenario. So we'll understand this with this slide. So here is Urkun plagiarism checker. And the moment an institute subscribes to Urkun, the students are now aware that their work is going to be run against Urkun plagiarism checker. So what happens is that the right set of expectations are being set here. The students are being told that their work will be scanned against Urkun. So the right expectation is set here. The students are being told that they need to write in their own words, because the document will be scanned by Urkun. Now, in order to write something in their own words, they need to inculcate their thoughts, they need to collect their thoughts, and for the process of collection of their thoughts, a lot of effort has to be put in. The students need to be more attentive in the classroom. They need to inculcate the habit of self-reading, as well as have a lot of discussion with their colleagues. So in one line, if I say Urkun is a tool that can make a difference, because the right set of expectations are being set on the students. We tell the students that their work is going to be checked, and because of that, the students put in efforts to collect their thoughts. In that process, they also become more attentive in the classes. A lot of self-reading is being done, and a lot of discussion is also being done with their colleagues. So in one line, Urkun is a tool that can make a difference. Let's now understand the unique features of Urkund. So these are a few of the unique features of Urkund. The first is monitoring with Urkund is easy. The second is individual faculty accounts are created. The students submit directly to the faculty members. We are able to find true plagiarism. It supports multiple Indian languages. We are GDPR 2018 compliant. And our focus is to improve the quality of education. Moreover, we do not sell it to ghostwriters or the students. Let's get with the details of each one of them. The first one is monitoring with Urkund is a very, very easy task. So basically, when an institution or a university starts using Urkund, we have an option to create organization levels or department levels for the faculty members as well as for the students. So up to two levels of hierarchy, we can create organization levels. For example, the faculties can be divided into science, arts, commerce, management, and so on. This is the first organization level. Further, the faculties of science are further divided into physics and chemistry. The arts can be divided into Hindi, library and information science, and so on. And the faculties of commerce, management, etc., can also be further divided based on their subjects. So what has happened is we have divided an institution or a university into various organization levels based on their departments or their subjects. And the benefit of this is that we are able to keep a track on the number of documents uploaded by each organization level. And we can see as to students from which organization levels have uploaded the documents, and we can go through the reports generated for each organization level separately. The next is the individual faculty accounts are created. Now the Urkund model enables every faculty to have their own account. So an individual faculty account is created for each of the faculty members who are registered who want to use Urkund, and hence the benefit that the students can directly submit to the faculty members. And past the assignment, coursework and project work would be available for faculty members for reference. So the faculties are able to keep a track on the submissions done by each organization, each of the students. So individual faculty accounts are created. The faculties can keep a track on the submissions done by each of the students. Moreover, the coursework as well as the project work are available for faculty members for further reference. The next is that the students submit directly to the faculty members, and this has a preventive effect. So here, each student can be provided with a submitter account in order to submit the document directly to the concerned faculty member. And here, students also have a log of all the submissions that they have done to the faculty. Now the question is, what is the preventive effect here? Let's understand with an example. Suppose I'm to board a train, I'm traveling, I've gone to the railway station to board a train, but somehow I was stuck in the traffic and I'm extremely late. So what would be the, I do not have the time to purchase the ticket also before boarding the train. So what I'll do is I may take a chance, I may board the train without the ticket, because there's a possibility, there's a probability that the ticket checker would not check my ticket and I would leave unescaped. At the same time, there's a probability that I can be checked by him and I would be imposed with a fine. So here I have equal probabilities for both. So I'm ready to take the chance. I may board the train without the ticket. But let us change the scenario. Let us assume that the ticket checker is present at the coach, at the door of the coach only, and he's letting only those people enter who have a valid ticket for them, with them. So in that case, only those passengers who have tickets will be able to enter the train, and I'll not be able to enter the train because I know that I do not have the ticket and the ticket checker is not going to let me in. In the same way, when the students are aware that they work, in the same way is this situation whereby the students are submitting their work to the faculty members. Ideally, if they need to submit their work to their faculty, they can still take a chance because they are under the impression that the faculty may check the work or he may not check the work also. So in that case, the student can take a chance. But when the student is aware that the document will be scanned by the system, in that case, he'll not be taking any chances and he would work on the content of the project or maybe his paper. He would put in all the efforts to write the paper and then only he will go ahead with the submission. So here the student will be putting in the required effort before submission of the papers. And this is what is the preventive effect in case of Urkund plagiarism checker. Let's also get into the next feature, that is the Urkund finds text manipulations. These days we have seen that circumventing plagiarism detection has become a common practice. We'll see lots of people practicing certain things because of which they can circumvent the plagiarism detection software. For example, there may be practices of homoglyphs whereby the concerned person has used some different scripts or writing system for some particular letters or characters in the document. So this practice of homoglyphs may be followed. Maybe there are white space manipulations by which what happens is that we may put a particular letter, we may put a particular character after each word in the sentence or in that particular paragraph so that the sentence or the paragraph becomes an abnormally longer word. In the same way, we could also try to put something within quotes in order to circumvent the plagiarism detection. We may also have options whereby we convert pictures of text in order to subvert the analysis. So for each of these cases or for cases like this, Urkund finds text manipulation and is able to provide us with the exact similarity report. So even if these practices are being followed to subvert the analysis, the system will be able to come up with the proper report. The next and a very important thing is that the system avoids false positive reports. So here, false positive is a very important concern in the reports. So here, we provide you with low frequencies of false positives. We show lower rate of false positives than the competitors, which is normally a good thing because teachers are rarely interested in seeing a match of 2 to 3 words such as this is it. Say there's a phrase, this is it. So the teachers may not be interested in these phrases of 2 to 3 words. And false positives are often seen as a clutter when teachers are using it in an authentic situation because it actually makes you to take more time rather than saving your time. Moreover, it also hides the real plagiarism. Suppose we would show you all the similarity that is there in the document, that is extremely false positives, it would be pointless to use Urkund. It would be like Googling a phrase, I do not know. You could try Googling this phrase, I do not know. And there we'll see that we get almost 4.7 billion matches here. And lot of false positives actually clutters the analysis to such an extent whereby the real plagiarism is hidden because of the false positives. And it would also increase the risk of wrongly accusing the students of plagiarism. Even if they have not plagiarized, they are being accused. Moreover, it is a very, very time consuming thing. And it would take so much time, the faculties would take so much time to go through it that it would be difficult for them to go through just 1 or 2 pages, let alone go through 40 to 50 pages. In this case, what happens is that only those documents will be scanned whereby there is a doubt of plagiarizing, and hence a sampling case there would be lot of undetected cases of plagiarism. So this could lead to a huge number of undetected cases. This is the reason why the system avoids false positives and comes up with true plagiarism report. Urkund also supports Indian languages. It supports over 30 languages, including Hindi, Sanskrit, English, Tamil, Telugu, Kannada, Turkish, French, German, Spanish, etc. These languages are being supported. The only thing that we need to keep in mind is that the documents need to be uploaded in Unicode compliant font so that the system is able to read them. Regional language documents can be uploaded provided they are in Unicode. Our system is not sold to ghostwriters. It is not for sale to ghostwriters or to cheaters. Basically, ghostwriting or contract writing is a serious problem at the university's level. Orkun does not give ghostwriters the possibility to deliver plagiarism report from Orkun along with the contract essay, making it harder for them to sell to students who are at the universities which are using Orkun. So we just sell to universities, not to individuals, not to students, because it is pointless to sell the system to universities as well as to students. It is actually meaningless. So we do not provide it to ghostwriters. We do not provide it to individuals and to the students also. We sell it only to the universities and the institutes. The next is that your data is yours and is secured. We follow the General Data Protection Regulation 2018. So we are GDPR 2018 compliant. So please be assured that documents submitted are confidential with Orkun. There are also certain regulatory requirements, but these are, of course, for master's and research level. So UGC has also come up with a lot of regulatory requirements. And there was a notification dated 23rd July 2018, which requires academic and research work for master's and research level and publications by both faculty and students to be original and with academic integrity. AICTE had also come up with a circular dated 30th November 2017, whereby they say that a credible anti-plagiarism software has to be used for academic and R&D work for MTech and BTech project report, PhD thesis, and research publication, etc. So the ways by which you can address plagiarism, since we are coming to the end of the plagiarism session, there are four ways by which you can address plagiarism. The first is that awareness needs to be created. We need to put in a lot of effort so that we are able to create the necessary awareness regarding plagiarism. Enough of this has been told to the students as to what is right and what is wrong, what is plagiarism and how to avoid it. But then the second step is that you should be able to detect it. So you should have an anti-plagiarism software in place which is able to detect it. The third is that there should be punishments. There should be punishments for those who do not follow the rules and regulations. Culture. So at the university level, at the institute level, policies and cultures have to be framed up so that we are able to deal with the issue of plagiarism. Now, this is my favorite slide. So here we are going to talk about where we are today and where we are headed towards. So this is the place, we are somewhere here whereby half empty and half full. And our focus is to find 100% plagiarism. Our focus is to find 100% sources for any of the documents, as well as to our goal is to achieve a state of 0% plagiarism. So we need to ensure that the goal and the focus are in the same direction. We are able to put in the required effort to ensure that 0% plagiarism state is being achieved. The students do not plagiarize, try to put in everything in their own words. Moreover, we are also able to find 100% similarity in all the documents. Now, we have already discussed plagiarism, and the second topic for today's session is Orkun and the details of using Orkun. So let's get to the details of Orkun here. Orkun is a technology leader. Basically, today's session covers Orkun. So here, Orkun is a technology leader, and this is a subscription-based cloud solution with in-house development. And the best part is that it can be integrated with any LMS. We are headquartered in Stockholm, Sweden, and we are also rapidly expanding our global footprints. So these are few of our customers in more than 80 countries. So these are few of our customers globally. You can have a look. These are the universities which are using Urkund. These are few of our customers. As also discussed, that we have more than 40 global partners in LMS. So these are few of the LMSs which with which Urkund can be integrated. So Urkund can be integrated with most of the widely used LMSs. The next is the Shodh Shuddhi program. As you are all aware, eGalactic or Urkund has been rolled out by eGalactic and InfliBNet under the aegis of MHRD to all the universities and CFTIs in India from 1st of September 2019 under Shodh Shuddhi program. And this is an initiative of MHRD, Government of India. And this project was launched by Honorable Minister of Human Resource Development, Sri Ramesh Pokhriyal Nishank, sir. And for more details of this, we could view here www.pds.inflibnet.ac.in/index.php or www.egalactic.in. So you could visit more details here at this page. Let's now understand as to how is Urkund an easy tool to use. So basically, there are two characters here. One is a submitter and the other is a receiver. Now, submitter, as the name suggests, is the person who can submit the document, and receiver, as the name suggests, is the person who can receive the report. So the submitter submits the document. The moment he has submitted the document, he'll get a confirmation email that a particular document has been uploaded. Later on, it would be then the system would be analyzing it. The document will be scanned for similarity check, and after that, a report is being generated. The next step is that the report is sent to the receiver with the similarity percentage, and here the receiver is able to analyze the report. So Urkund enables all the faculties to have individual accounts so that the students can submit the document directly to the faculty members, achieving the purpose of addressing plagiarism. So here, individual faculty accounts are being created for all the faculty members. And the benefit of this is that the students can submit the document directly to the faculty members. And this is the basic purpose of addressing plagiarism. Now here, the submitter is the person who can only submit the documents, and generally the students are the one who submit the document, and receivers are generally the faculty members or the supervisors. They can view the report, and by default, when we create a receiver account for a particular person, he gets the right to access the report as well as submit the document. So the submitter is only able to submit the document. He cannot view the reports, but the receiver, that is the faculty member or the supervisor, can view the reports as well as submit the document. So by default, the receiver will also be given the access to submit the documents. Now, let us get to the user training part. So here is the quick guide to get started. We are going to discuss the following points here: the process by which we register the faculties on the system, how can we register the students, the modes by which we access Urkund, document submission, as well as the Urkund report part. Let me take you through the first one, that is the receiver or the faculty registration process. Here, the accounts are being created by the university or the institute coordinator. The faculties can start using Urkund when the accounts have been created by the university or institute coordinator, and this account is the receiver account. Now, the moment the accounts have been created, the members receive an email from noreply@urkund.se, and this mail has the subject, "Welcome to Urkund." In this mail, there is a link whereby the faculties should be activating the link within the stipulated time of 96 hours. The link which is given in the mail is valid only for 96 hours, But if the link is not activated within the stipulated time of 96 hours, it would get expired, and then you need to send request to the university coordinator or the support team at support@egalactic.in, and then a new link will be sent to you. This is a screenshot of the mail which is received here. The first thing that we notice is that this mail has been sent, that the subject of this mail is "Welcome to Urkund." This is the receiver mail subject. Moreover, when I scroll down here, enclosed within this red box, I'm able to see there's a unique analysis address. Let us understand the analysis address in such a way that just like each student of an institute or an organization is being provided with a roll number or a registration number, in the same way, each and every faculty that is registered on the system will be provided with a unique analysis address. This is a system-generated analysis address, and the very purpose to create this analysis address is to ensure that each and every document that you upload reaches the concerned faculty account. Actually, any document that you want to check has to be sent as an attached file to this particular analysis address only. Now, this analysis address is connected to your personal email, so reports, once they are ready, will be sent to your personal email. Apart from receiving the reports onto your personal email ID, each user also has a personal web-based inbox where he or she receives the Urkund reports. And in order to use the personal inbox, we need to click onto the link which is available in additional functionality option here at the bottom of the report. We need to click onto this link. Once we have clicked onto this link, the next page will open up, whereby we are expected to enter a few details. Kindly be noted that this link works only for 96 hours, and suppose you need to activate your link, suppose if you are unable to activate the link within the stipulated time of 96 hours, in that case, you need to send a request to the support team or the coordinator for a new link. Now, once I click onto this link, I'm taken to the next page, whereby I'm supposed to enter a few details like my name, password. I'll retype my password and select a language. Once I accept the terms of service and click on create, I'll get a notification that Urkund account has been configured for you and the registration process has been completed for me. So the next is, how do we log into Urkund? This is the first step to log into Urkund. Here we have logged on to www.urkund.com, which is the official Urkund page. In this right top side, there's a link to upload documents, and there's a login prompt. Once I click on to login, I'm taken to the next page, whereby there's an option called web app. I need to click on to web app, and once I've clicked here, the login page opens up, whereby the username and the password has to be entered. And after clicking on to login, you will be able to access your login portal. So this is how the portal looks like. In this portal, left top side, I'm able to see the analysis address that has been generated for me. So this is the analysis address of the faculty. And on the right top side, there's a link to upload the documents. Here, we are able to see the document reference number. Any document that you upload onto the system will be provided with a unique document reference number. And this document reference number is specifically useful in those cases when we are trying to coordinate with the support team regarding any query. In that case, this document reference number has to be mentioned. Then we also have the name of the document, and here there's a percentage sign which signifies the percentage copied found in the uploaded document. This is the percentage of similarity and can range anything between 0% to 100%. Then we will have the other details like size of the document, number of words in the document, and last but not the least, we have the document log, that is the date and time of submission. So all these details are visible here. And as I was talking, This percentage signifies the percentage of similarity found in the uploaded document and can range anything between 0% to 100%. Let's now understand the process of student or the submitter registration. Now, the submitter registration process is also regulated from the ends of your university or institute coordinator. So you can send your request to the coordinator for registering you as an Urkund submitter. Now the registered member receives an email from noreply@urkund.se with the subject account creation invitation. And in this mail also, there is a link which is valid only for 96 hours, and you need to activate the link within the stipulated time, otherwise it will get expired. So this is the mail that is being received here, and this mail has the subject account creation invitation. Now scrolling further, here we are able to see only an account activation link, and this link is visible here in blue. I need to simply click onto this link, and once I click onto this link, the next page will open up whereby I need to enter my details like my email ID, my name, etc. And once I click on create, I'll get a notification that the registration process has been completed. So this is how the submitters can get their accounts activated. Now, the process of accessing the submitter, the login portal for the submitter, for that, again, we have the option. We need to log into www.urkund.com, and you need to click onto the login tab. So once you click onto the login tab, you click onto web app, and then you are brought here. Here, you need to type in your email ID or your username and your password. And once you click onto login, you will be able to access your submitter portal. Now in the login portal of the submitter account, there are two differences here. The first is that the percentage sign is not visible here because the report is not being shared with the submitter. And the second is that on the left top side, we are not able to see the analysis address. Instead, the email ID of the concerned submitter will be visible here. Otherwise, the details that are here in the submitter portal are document reference number, name of the document, there's a link to upload documents, and there's also date and time of submission. These details are visible in the login portal of the submitter account. Let's discuss the third part, that is the modes by which we can access Urkund. There are three ways by which we access Urkund. The first is accessing Urkund using your email. The second is accessing Urkund using the web portal. And the third is accessing Urkund using the learning management system. So these are the three ways by which we can access Urkund. Accessing Urkund using your email. Your email account is linked to your unique analysis address. So any document that you want to upload can be uploaded using your email to the particular analysis address. The moment you upload a particular document, you will receive the system-generated confirmation that a particular document has been uploaded. Later on, once the report has been generated, again you receive a mail stating that the report is ready, and that mail contains a link using which you can access the analysis report. The second way to access Urkund is using your web portal. So we can also log in through the web portal as suggested in the registration process. And the third way is accessing Urkund using the learning management system. We just talked about it, that Urkund can be integrated with LMS. So you can also access Urkund using your learning management system. Let's now discuss the ways by which we can upload a particular document. So the first one is document submission by email. This is the first way to upload the particular document, and the process to upload a document using your email is similar to sending a mail to a particular person. Here, I've clicked in the compose box in my email. So this kind of a page has opened up, whereby the first thing that I need to enter is a valid analysis address. So here I have entered the analysis address of the faculty. The second is I'll be typing the subject as well as the message. Urkund gives you the option to enter any subject and any message of your choice. The next would be to attach the document for similarity. And once you have attached the document for similarity, you can click on to send. And the moment you click on to send, then the document will be uploaded using your email. So the process is exactly similar to sending a mail. The only difference is that instead of here an email ID, we have typed in the analysis address. The next way to upload the document is document upload by portal. For that, we will be logging onto our portal. In the portal, right top side, there's a link to upload documents. So once I click onto this link, I'll be taken to the next page, whereby the first thing that I need to do is enter a valid analysis address. In case, if you are uploading to self, that means you are a receiver, then you can select your analysis address from the drop-down menu. But in case, if you are a submitter, you are uploading document to someone else, there you need to enter the analysis address of the concerned faculty to whom you wish to upload the document. And once you have entered the analysis address, when we are selecting from drop-down menu, then there will be no error of analysis address. But when analysis is written, the tick box will appear only when the analysis address included is right. So this is a very important step. The tick sign should come here, should be visible here after the analysis address has been entered, because it signifies that the analysis address entered is correct. After that, proceed on with entering the subject as well as the message. Once you have entered the subject and the message, the next step is to attach the document for similarity check. So all the valid file extensions which are being supported by Urkund will be mentioned in this page. We are able to see that the most common formats are being supported, like DOC, SXW, TIFF, PDF, TXT, RTF, HTML, WPS, XLS, PPT, ODT, etc. So the entire list of valid file extensions will be mentioned here in the document upload page of the login portal. So the next step is to attach the document for similarity. And once you have attached the document for similarity, then the submit button will be highlighted. Now, the submit button will be highlighted in orange only when both the analysis address is correct and the document has been attached. In case if you have either not entered the correct analysis address, or maybe the document has not been attached, in that case, the submit button will not be enabled. The submit button will be enabled only when a valid analysis address is entered as well as the document has been attached. So you click on to submit, and the moment you click on to submit, document will be uploaded. And once you have uploaded using your portal, you will be able to see that the document reference number, name of the document, as well as the other details of the document will be visible in your portal. So this signifies that the document has been uploaded successfully. But if the document is not visible in the portal, in that case, please check whether the account has been activated or not, because the document will be visible if the account was activated. So this was the second way by which we upload the document. The third way by which we can upload document is upload using your port, using the learning management system. So as we discussed, Urkund can be integrated with any LMS. So the third way to upload it is by using learning management system. Now let's get to the next part, that is the report part. So the question that arises is, how are we being told that the report has been generated? There are two options available to view the report. The first is report link is received on the receiver's registered email address from report at analysis be received by you from report at analysis.ucom.com, and this mail will have a link here. So this is the link which is there at the bottom part of the mail. You need to click onto this link so that the report opens up in a new page. But sometimes it so happens that the report does not open. In that case, please check whether the pop-up has been allowed or not. And in case if the pop-up has not been allowed, please disable the pop-up blocker. Kindly be noted that report is generated generally within 30 minutes with a maximum of 24 hours. The second way by which you are being informed that the report is available is using the receiver portal. So once the report is ready in the receiver portal, we will be able to see a percentage sign. So this percentage signifies that the report is ready. And once you click onto this percentage, the report will open up in a new page. Please disable the pop-up blocker if the new page does not open. Let's now get started with the most important part, that is the analysis report. So this kind of a report is being generated. This is the first page of the report, that is the analysis overview page, whereby we are able to visualize the report. So at this page, we are able to see as to how does the report looks like. Here in this analysis overview page, I'm able to see certain parts of the document that have been highlighted in orange and others in purple. So the ones that have been highlighted in orange are actually the instances where similarity has been found. So this actually signifies that a matching text is found in this particular page. So all those parts of the document where some matching was found, where some similarity was found, will be highlighted in orange, and other parts which are highlighted in purple signify that some kind of warning has been generated for this document. So sometimes what happens is that some different scripts or writing systems have been used in the document. Maybe so there's some abnormal use of characters. So in those cases, a warning can be generated. And in case if there's a warning, it would be highlighted in purple. So this is how we are able to see in the document overview bar. Actually, we are having a quick look at the findings in the document. And once we click onto the findings, we will get details about that specific match or warning. And we have the option to investigate it further in the findings view. So you have the option to click on any of the findings and get details about that findings tab. So suppose if I click here at a particular finding, this is how the details are visible. I'm able to see a snippet of the matching text or an explanation of the warning. Please go straight to the findings view if you wanted to see the details of the findings view. So if you wanted to further see the details of this particular matching text, you could click onto the view details tab. Otherwise, we can simply click on next to have a quick overview at all the pages of the report. So here, when we click on a particular matching text, we are able to see number of words that have been found in this particular matching text. We are able to see name of the source for this particular matching text. Moreover, we also have options to view the details. If you wanted to see this particular paragraph in findings tab, we could click on the view details option. The next is the findings tab. This box actually tells us how many findings are there in the document. So we can navigate to the findings view, whereby we can investigate the detected findings closely side by side with the matching text. And here we distinguish between matching text and warnings, so they can be read separately. If you wanted to see the detected findings closely side by side with their matching source text, in that case, you could click on these icons. And once you click onto these icons, it will open up in a new tab whereby side by side comparison is possible. But suppose if we do not want to have a look at the findings tab, we instead wanted to go through the entire document. In that case, we will click onto this view the entire document tab. And once we click here, we'll be able to see the entire document. So here, if you wanted to see the complete report, we could click on view the entire document tab. Now, after this, the next button that we have here, just a minute. Now, the next button that we have here on the right top side are the export and help buttons. In case if you wanted to export the analysis as a PDF and download it onto your system, you could click onto the downward arrow key, which is visible here. So if you click onto the downward arrow key, the document will be downloaded into a PDF and will be saved onto your system. Moreover, we also have a question mark sign here, which will open up the quick start guide in a new tab for you. Now, the next one is the similarity bars here. So here we have the similarity bars. We actually display two similarities. The first is this assignment's aggregated similarity percentage, and the second is the receiver's average similarity, that is the average similarity of all the documents submitted to this particular receiver. So all these, the percentage details can be visible here in the similarity bars. The next are the submission details tab, whereby we find all the necessary information about the document, such as the submitter name, date and time of submission, submission ID, and the other details like the number of words in that particular submission, the message that was given with this document, and so on. So all the details regarding the submission are visible here in this submission detail. Now, the next one are the quick options. So here we have three options. The first is the reset option. The second is the export to PDF option. And the third is the quick start guide. So here we have the refresh option. Anytime maybe you have deselected a few sources and suppose you have made any kind of changes here, and you wanted to refresh the report, you want to reload the report back to its original form, in that case, you could click onto this refresh button and the report will be restored in its original form. The next is, if you want to export the analysis as a PDF and download it onto your system, you could click onto the downward arrow key, and then the report will be converted to PDF to be saved onto your system. And the third one is the question mark sign, which will open up the quick start guide. The next is the findings tab. So here we are actually able to visualize all the matching text as well as the warnings. So in this findings tab, the first option is show in text option. Under the show in text option, we have quotes, we have brackets, and we have detailed text differences. If we enable the quotes option, all those parts of the document which were put within quotes will be highlighted. So if you want to see all those parts of the document that were put within quotes, you could enable these options and they can be highlighted. The second is brackets. If you want to highlight all those parts of document that were put within brackets, you could enable this option. And once this option has been enabled, all those parts of the document that were put within brackets will be highlighted. And the third is the detailed text difference tab. Now, here we also have the types, and these types help us to navigate between different types of findings. We were talking that if there is a matching text, it would be highlighted in orange. If there's a warning, it will be highlighted in purple. So here we have the types. You can click on either of them to navigate between matching text as well as the warnings. Then we also have side-by-side boxes here. So this side-by-side box helps you to compare between the submitted text and the matching text. Now let's get into the details of each one of them, the type of findings we've already discussed. Then we have the show in text option. As I discussed, if we enable the quotes part, all those parts of the quotes option, all those parts of the document which were put within quotes will be enabled. The second is the brackets option. If you enable this option, all those parts of the document which were put within brackets will be highlighted. And the third is the detailed text differences. The detailed text difference actually brings to your notice the exact difference between the submitted text and the matching text, because it highlights the difference in the matching text. When you enable this option, you would be able to see in the source text, you will be able to see certain words being highlighted in yellow and others in pink. The words that have been highlighted in yellow are those parts that have been modified, and the words that have been highlighted in pink are those parts which have been deleted. So all kind of text tampering, all kind of differences between the uploaded text as well as the matching source text will be highlighted in case if you enable this option, show detailed text differences. The next are the side and side boxes. So in these boxes, we are able to see the text, the submitted student text to the left. So here is the submitted student text on the left side, and on the right side, I'm able to see the text from the matching source. So left side is your uploaded work and right side is the content of that particular source from where similarity was found. You could also say this is the text from the matching source to the right. And here in the side by side box, one more thing can be noticed by you, that apart from overall similarity percentage, for example, the overall similarity percentage is 50%. Apart from the overall similarity percentage, you are also able to see individual similarity percentage in each of the matching texts. So here in this particular matching text, we are able to see 98% similarity has been found. So for this specific block of text, the percentage of similarity will also be highlighted. The number of words that are there in this matching text is also visible. Moreover, we also have options like include in report, in case if you think that a particular part of the document, if you think that a finding is irrelevant, example, if it is correctly cited, maybe it has been put within quotes, you can choose to exclude the finding from the report. For that, we need to click onto the toggle option. And once we toggle off this, the finding will be, that has been the matching source text will be excluded in the report. That is, it will no longer affect the document's aggregated similarity. So in case if a finding is irrelevant due to any reason, you could exclude it by unchecking the toggle button. And once you exclude this, then the finding will be excluded from the report and the document's aggregated similarity score would be recalculated. The next is the source info or the link here. So here we are able to see the link to the original source. I'm able to see link to the source document or to the website. Here we have the link. Once I click onto this link, I'll be able to visit the original source. Moreover, there is a symbol next to it, and this symbol tells us what type of source it was. So W means website, SA means student assignment, and J means content from a journal. Also, there's an option called T. So T stands for textbook. So the link to the original source, as well as the type of source, whether it is journal, article, textbook, or journal, textbook, they will be represented with some particular symbols also. Now, there are also something called alternative sources. So basically, when the system checks a particular document for similarity check, so a lot of sources are being generated. And here in the findings tab, when we are having a side-by-side comparison, we are able to see the primary source or the most important source from where maximum similarity was found. But there could be times when the matching source is not what you expect it to be. No worries at all. Our system displays the source it thinks is the most relevant, but it also keeps overlapping matches as alternative sources. That is, these are the sources which also contain similarity to this particular block of text. Now, suppose if you do not want to have this primary source, you instead wanted to look at the alternative sources under this. So there, what you can do is you can click on alternative sources under source link Here we can have under the source link, you could see alternative sources, or you can view alternatives which are hidden under the hidden menu. So here in the hidden menu, three dots are there. If you click here, we are able to see there's a view alternative option. If you click onto this, then an alternative, then the primary match will be automatically removed, and the alternative match will be visible. Here, the primary match will be sent to the bin and the alternative match will be visible. But at any point of time, if you want to revert this action, you can also restore this from the bin. So apart from the primary sources, for a particular matching text, you can also see the alternative sources in which similarity was found. So here, once I clicked there, we are able to see there's an option, switch to an alternative overlapping match. And in this option, if I click on to view alternatives, we get the option to choose which alternative source to include. So here, the system gives me an option to select which alternative source needs to be included, because alternative matches are actually bundled in what we say levels, because an overlap could actually be matches from several sources. So here we could expand the levels by clicking onto this drop-down menu so that we are able to see which sources are in it, and we can choose which one to include in this particular matching text. Now, there's also something called exempted source. Many a times in the side-by-side comparison, if you see, in the right side, we are not able to see the text from the original source. Instead, we get a notification like this: the document has been exempted as a viewable source in the Orkun archive by the author. Or maybe it is written, the document is stored in Orkun partner section and is listed as inaccessible. This could be due to the reason that maybe the author has chosen to exempt the document, or maybe we have an agreement with our partners. So in case if we have an agreement with our partners that that their content would not be shown, in that case, we'll get a note like this. Otherwise, if the author has chosen to exempt the content, in that case also, in the side-by-side matches, you will not be able to see content of that source from where similarity was found. Now, in the findings tab, we were talking that suppose if you remove a primary source, so you will be able to see the primary source here in this bin. So this is the removed findings in which we are able to see the details of that particular source from where similarity was found. So suppose you chose to see an alternative source and you've removed the primary source. Later on, if you wanted to go back to that primary source, so in the removed findings tab, you could click here in this findings bin, and this is where we find removed matches. That is, these are the matches which have been removed due to an alternative match being included. So here we have the option to restore them if you wish to bring them back to the analysis. So those sources which you have removed because you wanted to see the alternative sources, those sources will be here in the findings bin. And if you want to restore any of them, you could click at this particular one, at this restore option, and those matches will be included again in the report. The next is the profile menu. Again, the profile menu has options to choose to enable the quotes, to enable the brackets. Then we also have options to enable detailed text differences. And then we also have the option to export the report. So in case if you want to export the report, it can be exported by clicking onto this option apart from the downward arrow key. Moreover, we also have option to share the report, language option, give feedback, quick start guide, and sign in option. So these options are there in the profile menu. You can change your settings. For example, you can change the language. You could open up the quick start guide. You could share the report and so on. So a lot of options are available in this profile menu. The next is the sources tab. So in the sources tab, we find the list of all the sources that we had found during the analysis. That is, these are the sources in which we have founded text similarities with the submitted document. So all the sources in which you found similarity, you found text similarity, those sources will be mentioned here. So you can see that. So here, again, in this sources tab, we have further option. The first one is the source list. This source list identifies the matching sources. Now the list of identified sources will be displayed in a separate view. You can view the original source by clicking on any one of them in the list. So here we have the list of all the sources that we have matched document content with, and we can view the original source by clicking on any one of them in the list. Now, the second is the source legend, or it is the type of source. So here we have icons, we have some symbols or icons here. So J stands for journal, T stands for textbook, W stands for website, and SA stands for student assignment or school assignment. It means those documents that have been submitted to Orkun and are now saved in the Orkun archive. The next is the location in document. It tells us where did we find the matches. So here, this bar shows where did matches to specific source occur in the document. You can click on any of the highlights to display a summary of the match, and you can head directly to the findings detail. So it tells us where did matches to specific source have occurred in the document. If you wanted to see the details of any of these highlights, you could click onto them. And once you click onto them, it will head directly to the findings detail tab. The next are the alternative sources here. So here, the alternatives to the primary sources. So when an analyzed text displays similarities with several sources, our system will display the most relevant one or the most important one based on the ranking of our algorithms. However, you can also find the alternative overlapping sources. That is, you can find the sources which also contain similarities to a particular block of text here. You can click onto this arrow, which is here, to expand the container and view more details. So here we have the downward arrow key. Once I click onto this arrow, then the alternative sources tab will open up. And in this alternative sources tab, we are able to see all the other sources from where similarity was found. So you can choose to omit a source from the analysis if you wish to. Here, we are able to view the alternative sources, and basically we can swap to another sources if you want. Here, we also have option to omit a source from the analysis if you wish to. For example, there's a particular primary source here. If I think that this source should not be considered for similarity check, so I can uncheck the toggle button here. Or maybe I can click onto the menu, which is hidden under the three dots, and the source will be excluded from the analysis. So you either uncheck this toggle button, or you click on the option on the hidden menu, which are here under the three dots, and the source will be excluded from the analysis. Now, when you are trying to omit the primary source and its matches, the system will ask you whether you want to include an alternative source instead. If you think that an alternative source needs to be included, you could click on yes and continue. And once you click onto that option, the system will instead compare your document with the alternative sources. And you can also switch to an alternative source by using the hidden menu. So using these hidden menus, you can switch on to alternative sources, etc. So this is how you can omit a particular source if you think that it is irrelevant. Now here, we also have an option of adding a missing source. So here you can add a URL or of a source you believe is missing. If you think that there is a source missing, that is, you are quite certain that a particular source has been used and is not visible here, you could place the URL of that source in the input field, and a request to index it will be sent to us. So the system will be informed that a request like this has come, and that particular source will be indexed to the database. The last tab that we have here is the entire document tab. So this is how the entire document tab looks like. In this entire document tab, the submitted document is shown in its entirety here. And all the findings will be highlighted in the text, allowing you to do a side-by-side comparison. So here, in this entire document tab, we are able to see certain parts being highlighted. So these colored parts of the document, they indicate matching text or the warnings. So we have colored parts, different color for matching text, different color for warnings. Moreover, we also have the findings icons here. So this is the document with the findings. And here we have the entire submitted document with findings highlighted in the text. So this is how it looks like. The highlighted findings actually tell you that matching text or warning has been found in the document. So the findings will be highlighted in the text. Orange means matching text and purple means a warning. And if you wanted to see the detail of this particular matching text, you could click onto the findings icon to open the side-by-side comparison. So once I click onto this icon, then the detail of this particular matching text will open up like this. Here we are able to see side-by-side comparison. Again, the left part shows the uploaded document and the right part shows the content of that source from where similarity was found, or it shows us the matching source text. So here we can compare the student text with the source text by clicking on the findings icon. The matching source text or the warning explanation is shown to the right of the submitted text. And the benefit of this is that we are able to do a side-by-side comparison. You can toggle on detailed text differences to make sure that you don't miss anything important. You can skip on to the next finding by using the panication on the sides or the arrows on your keyboard. So you can simply click onto the next so as to have the look at the next matching text. And here also, apart from overall similarity percentage, that is 50% or whatever percentage may be, here also we are able to see percentage of similarity for this matching text. And we also have option to exclude it from the report in case we think it is irrelevant. So this is how we read and understand the report. And with this, we have come to the end of this session. And for sales and support, you can write to us at support@egalactic.in. And here are the numbers also. You can call us at 84120-02525, or you can also write to us, and you can also log into www.egalactic.in. And for sales, you can contact sales@egalactic.in. Just a minute. So let's get started with the question answer round here. In case if there were queries, we could discuss them for now.
Hi, good afternoon. This is Prakash here. Thank you, Preeti, for the wonderful session. I think we have a total of maybe more than 150 questions. We understand that we may not have sufficient time to answer all of those questions. We'll try to take up the questions that we can answer within the stipulated time. In case if those questions remain unanswered, we will respond back to your questions. So you'll get a response on your mail for your questions. And if you have any further questions as well, you can write to either support@egalactic.in and we will be more than happy to answer those questions. So we'll try to answer most of the questions. So Preeti, do you want to start with answering the questions which we have received on the question and answer tab?
Yeah, we could start with the with answering the questions.
I think the first question.
Yeah, the first question is which is better between Orkun and Turnitin or Ithenticate? So basically, we do not like compare with our competitor products. We talk about our features, we talk about our product, and we would not be comparing between the with the other competitor products. The next question was, how can a librarian prevent plagiarism? So basically, when a document is being scanned for similarity, a particular percentage of similarity is generated for the uploaded document. So we would request the subject matter expert the faculty member to go through the document, to go through the report, and then decide as to what needs to be done, because the percentage that is being generated talks about percentage of similarity and not about plagiarism. So whether you will find that as plagiarized, whether you'll consider that as plagiarized or not, that is left up to the discretion of the subject matter expert. And the first step that needs to be done is create a lot of awareness. We need to create awareness. We need to have it being clearly mentioned as to what needs to be done and what need not to be done. The students should be clear about it, so that when they are uploading the documents, they do not make those mistakes. The next question is, every university is subscribed to Orkun, but scholars are not given permission to use it. It is only given at the time of submission or thesis. Why can't we use it for our work, like for papers or other things as well? So as per...
this question?
Yeah, this is a student question.
I think just one point I would want to clarify here is that, first is that this session was more from a focused perspective for addressing plagiarism, especially at bachelor's level. And the reason for that is, as mentioned, because we need to ensure that we have the right foundation for the students. The policies, there are UGC policies, which essentially are more towards master's and research work and faculty work and PhD work. There are guidelines in that which are applicable for bachelor's work, which is about creating awareness about plagiarism. This session especially was a focus on addressing plagiarism mostly at bachelor's and undergraduate level, and even before that. Globally, these tools are also used at primary and secondary schools level. In India, we are taking up this initiative to address this at a bachelor's level. Now, having said that, Orkun right now has been rolled out essentially through MHRD and InfliptNet and UGC to all the universities for all the research work and PhD related work and faculty work. However, Orkun is available now. So the concerned librarians or faculty members, you can contact if you want Orkun for your bachelor's or master's level of work to sales@egalactic.in, and we will be more than happy to help you. So having said that, Orkun as a tool has been provided now to all the institutes, all the universities, but the implementation of the tool is within the purview of the university. So the university may decide the policies that they want to follow and the excess that they want to do. So it is completely up to the university. So please contact your university coordinator to understand the policies that is being implemented in your particular university and who all are being provided access to Orkun. Thank you. Preeti, we can move to the next question.
Okay. The next question is Orkun plagiarism a reliable software for researchers to check in plagiarism in engineering field? Of course, it is a reliable tool and it can be used for engineering field also.
So So, I'll take up the next question. Can you give examples of what not to cite? So there are a lot of content that you read and refer to, and everything that you are reading and referring to is not something that you are quoting. So if you are not using that particular kind of content that you have read and referred, you don't need to actually cite it.
Can you please move ahead, Prakash, with the other questions as well?
I think the next is whether UGC guidelines are applicable for undergraduate students. So as I already covered, there are guidelines which are there. However, those notifications in terms of the percentage are more applicable for master's and PhD level work and also for research work. So the next question is, does Urkund work on running for math questions? So Urkund as a tool basically is able to detect similarities. So we will be able to detect similarities also if there are large number of texts which are similar exactly. The next question is, what's the meaning of paraphrasing? So paraphrasing is when the same text is essentially modified and represented in your own words with some changes actually. Now, there are different definitions of paraphrasing, and there are, I would say, some parts of paraphrasing, some way of paraphrasing is acceptable, and some ways of paraphrasing it is not acceptable. Now, these are essentially depending on the technique that you're using for citation and quotation. It depends on that. You can refer to your guidelines, more university guidelines, to understand more about that. The next question is related to whether you should refer or not. So if you're reading a paper from which you're getting ideas, you should definitely include those in your bibliographies. And you should also use the right quote and references. The next question again is there a plagiarism policy to the degree college, PG degree universities? So there are a plagiarism policy which is already there by UGC, which is applicable for universities and for master's courses and research work. For undergraduate levels, I think the policy is completely dependent on the university. There are guidelines which are to be followed, but the universities can come up with their own policies, and also the colleges can come up with their own policies. So the next question is, if I cite the source, can I still be accused of plagiarism? If the sources are rightly cited, then it is not plagiarized. However, Urkund as a tool helps find similarity, but the concerned faculty member or the guide or the administrator is the person who can review the entire report and find out whether it is actually similarity or plagiarism. Because it is completely up to the subject matter expert to understand what is acceptable and what is not acceptable. And it also depends on the topic. There may be things which, there are certain general principles obviously which cannot be changed, so which would always be there. So any tool can essentially help to find similarities only. And finally, the plagiarism percentage is either decided by the supervisor or the subject matter expert. Next question is plagiarism important for bachelor degree students? If it is, where are we going to implement? It's a very good question, and we feel that plagiarism is important at all levels, not just at bachelor's level, but also at primary and secondary school level. I think we have got started significantly, and over the last 5 years, there has been a significant progress in terms of addressing plagiarism, starting all the way right at the top from the PhD and the faculty level to master's level. And we hope that there are also guidelines now from AICT where they require certain bachelor level projects also to be run through an anti-plagiarism tool. So I think just one from a perspective of policy and requirement, there's generally a focus there where it is being tried to address at a bachelor level. Further, if we kind of forget from a requirement of a regulation and just ask ourselves as faculty members, as teachers, and as people who are contributing to the education sector and focusing on improving the quality that we are imparting to the education, we probably need to address plagiarism. And then as we shared in our slides, addressing plagiarism has four important pillars. And one of them is also about creating awareness and having the right policy, having the right tools, and also having the right set of deterrent, maybe a deterrent, which may be in terms of penalty, punishments, or also probably creating more and more awareness. But it's important for us to get started so that we can essentially address placement in the longer run. Could you brief about self-placement, how to handle? So I think last week there is a guideline from UGC which clearly states that even if you are referring to your own paper, you need to cite it appropriately. So even if you are like copying your own content, if you have already published it earlier, and you need to ensure that you rightly cite that particular document or paper that you are referring to. Next is, can open check image falsification or fabrication? We are still working on that. We do not yet have a tool to kind of help you find with the similarity of images. It's quite complicated and requires a lot of advanced technologies. Right now, open cannot check images actually. What's the similarity and difference between plagiarism and copyright? We would not be the expert to handle that. But very briefly, plagiarism is copyright. Plagiarism when you're copying someone else's content, and copyright is more a registered process where you essentially have a right which is registered or unregistered, but you have a right of your content and you do not allow anyone else to be copying it. Next question is, universities insist only on percentage of plagiarism and not other factors. What shall we do as the researchers? As we mentioned, this entire focus of this presentation was more from a bachelor's purpose. From a university perspective, there is a clear guideline from UGC perspective, which states that only up to 10% is what is acceptable, and beyond it is not acceptable.
Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Can we end the session here? They can send you the questions at your emails because we are, I think we have added the time.
So I think there are maybe other questions. We have a list of questions. We will respond back to your questions. Thank you for sending across your questions and thank you for attending this session. We hope it was useful and have added value. We would look for your feedback to make it more comprehensive. For the questions that we have not been covered, please be rest assured we will send you a reply from support@egalactic.in. And if you need further clarifications, feel free to reach out to us. And our apologies for not being able to cover all the questions. There are certain questions that not the question. Those were either remarks or questions which are already repeated. So we thought that it's the same question and hence we have dismissed that. So apologies for that as well. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everyone. Hello. Thank you, everyone, to be the part of webinar. The webinar was attended by more than 450 participants at Zoom and around 300 people.
Madam, let me correct you. At one point of time, there were 387.
Okay, sir. And at Facebook, we had more than 300 people. Thank you, everyone, for this huge response. Certificate can be given, and they will be given to those only who just leave the meeting after this session, after my concluding remarks. This webinar was organized by eGalactic in association with Postgraduate Government College for Women, for Girls Sector 42, Chandigarh, and Birla Institute of Management Technology, Greater Noida, in collaboration with Ranganathan Society for Social Welfare and Library Development. Me and Rishi sir are associated with this NGO. Rishi sir is secretary and I'm just helping him out. I thank Professor Binu Dogra, principal of Postgraduate College, Chandigarh, and Dr. Harivan Chaturvedi for allowing us to do this webinar. I thank the team of Urkun, Prakash Sada, and Gautam Raval for organizing this webinar. I thank the speaker of the day, Preeti Rathi, for delivering this informative talk. I think you all agree with me. My thanks.
I think you are forgetting a very important person who is extending our his technical support, Mr.
Deepak Sarda.
Deepak Sarda.
Hanji.
So he is always there with us to help us. So sincere thanks to him also.
I thank you, sir, Dr. Rishi Tiwari.
Thanks.
Who holds the responsibility for organizing this workshop and webinar. Thank you, everyone. And we'll come back with some other program soon. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you, everyone. Bye-bye.